Excuse me, I've got a little allergy tickle, I guess. It's not you. Excuse me. Good morning and welcome to Ann Street United Methodist Church here in Beaufort, North Carolina. Whether you are live streaming or you're listening to us on the radio or you're here in the sanctuary, all of this adds to the power of our worship together. Kandice is going to, for the prelude, is going to play Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. This hymn, the text to this hymn was written by John Wesley. He wrote 17 verses, and I'm only going to share a couple of them with you, okay? But there's a couple that really resonated with me this morning, and I hope that it puts you in the spirit of worship that will help us all. Then with my heart I first believed with faith divine, power with the Holy Ghost received to call the Savior mine. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad, the honors of thy name. Thank you, Kandice. We have quite a few announcements this morning. I'll begin by reminding everyone that a brief special church council Zoom meeting has been called for next Sunday. That's February 14th at 3:15 p.m. And it's concerning the Your Building renovation. So church council members, please check your email for details. As you know, Lent is fast approaching. And Ash Wednesday is the first day of Lent. It is a reminder of our mortality and our dependence on God. So safety precautions during the coronavirus time are calling us to be creative, to find ways to meaningfully observe our rituals, but in a safe fashion. So we invite you to participate in our Ash Wednesday service on February 17th at 6 o'clock by watching live stream. You can pick up from the church office a small baggie of ashes. They're also available in the narthex, the church office, or they can be mailed to you upon request. When you get them home, you're going to mix them with a small amount of olive or vegetable oil. And then watching the live stream service, when Pastor Taylor advises, you are going to make the sign of the cross on your forehead. So let's begin Lent in a meaningful and safe way. You can participate in Ash Wednesday by live stream. Don't forget to pick up your ashes. We are in need of a full-time assistant teacher for the two-year-old class at our preschool. If you'd like to send your resume in, you may do so. It's annstreetpreschool@gmail.com, or you can call Chris Barnes. And Taylor, I think you have an announcement.
Yes, thank you. Lee, while I'm thinking of it, will you make sure that the, or at least ushers, make sure that the ashes are back here? Are the ashes in little baggies back here? Have you guys seen them? Lee, can you look around and see what Polly did with those? If you can find them, yeah. See if you can make sure we got those so people can pick them up today. Thanks, Lee. Today is Scouting Sunday, so we want to DJ coming forward today to light our candles and all of our scouts. Emily, my own Emily Mills, is a Girl Scout, and we celebrate her. We've got some other scouts in the congregation, I'm sure. And we host a Girl Scout troop at our church as well. That meets upstairs in the Year Building. So we're grateful for our scouts and celebrate them today. I want to welcome and invite Hannah Townsend to come up. she's let me put my microphone on so Hannah can use the pulpit microphone here. Hannah, come on up. Many of you might know Hannah already because she has already been here at Ann Street in several capacities for a few years. Her mother, Becky, is here, and Becky is a retired principal in the area, so I'm sure many of you educators in the congregation know her as well. And her grandmother, Pat, is with us too, and Pat has played piano for us again here at Ann Street on several occasions, and I believe there's been some singing involved and some other things, so Pat's going to play a surprise piano solo today. Thank you, Pat, for doing that. We're glad that you're... No, she's not. I'm teasing. But Hannah is our new communications associate through the church. Rachel Dawson has started that position, done a great work, but is expecting her new baby very soon. So she decided it was time to pass the baton. And on behalf of the SPPRC, we had a lot of wonderful, wonderful applications and excellent pool to choose from, and it was a very hard decision. But the PPRC asked Hannah, and she graciously accepted to do this work. We thank you, Hannah. We welcome you, and perhaps you want to say a greeting to the congregation.
I just wanted to say thank you so much, everyone, for this opportunity, and I'm looking forward to working with all of you very soon.
That's great. If you have any announcements, be sure and let the church office know, and we'll let Hannah know too. And her email is communications@annstreetumc.org. So thank you, Hannah. Congratulations and welcome. Let's give her a welcome. That's all.
And now we bring you our ministry moment from the United Methodist Women.
Are you trapped in I don't know what I'm supposed to be doing? Ladies, are you trapped in the I can't do the things I used to rut? Has your life been ambushed by the COVID virus, just like a bad reality TV show? Friends, it doesn't have to be this way. We have your United Methodist Women to the rescue. Faith, hope, love in action. We have taken a good look at ourselves, our organization. All we could see were things that used to work well with us, like that old bizarre outfit in your closet or church. So we have run to our closet to pull out those classics that still work for us. We fundraised with apple and sweet potato sales. We had to keep our secret sisters too, but decided to pick up a little something extra for them at the boutique. And now that we're thinking outside of the box, we've decided to add some new accessories to enhance our new look, like Zoom meetings and a Facebook group. All ways that we can have our new digital devotions and book study. The United Methodist Women are stepping out with a new courageous color, paired with a new challenge, clothed in courage. United Methodist Women. What does that mean for us now?
We've looked in the mirror. We've gone in our closets. We've been to the boutique. We know how we want to look, but how do we get there? How do we put on that purple and make it shine? How do we step out with courage? By using all the new tools that God is giving us, the Zoom, the Facebook. So join me. Step out. Put on a new pair of shoes, and let's move into the future together.
Thank you, Karen Willis and Marsha Serkin, for that ministry moment. Our opening prayer this morning is, Holy One, with our ancestors and all the people of God, we gather to sing your praises. You are the one who has created the cosmos. You give food to whales and sparrows, name the stars, and count the hairs on our heads. Inspire us this day to turn our praise into action, to share your good news with those who long to hear a word of hope. Praise to you. Amen. And it's now your turn to praise one another and share the love with our passing of the peace. You know, you can rise in your seat at home. You know what to do with your little hearts and flowers and all of that online. So please, pass the peace. Don't we all feel more peaceful now and well-loved? It is my pleasure to introduce a video of music this morning from our own Ann Street Choir. He gives us peace. Thank you. me homesick for the choir loft. Our children's message is brought to us digitally today by Julia Royall Johnson.
Hey guys, good morning. Welcome to the children's sermon. I'm so excited to talk to you about today's Bible verse from 1 Corinthians. Now, this is Paul's letter to the people of Corinth, and he's talking to them about a lot of different things, and he's saying that he feels he must tell everyone and anyone all about the gospel, that he can't help it. It's involuntary. It just comes out from him. He says he must tell people that go to church, people that don't go to church. He says he must tell people that do everything right, and he must tell people that make mistakes. He says he must tell people that are depressed and sad, and he must tell people that are happy and think that they know everything. He must tell everyone, and he doesn't even want to get paid for it because it's been given to him for free, and he must save as many people as he can by telling them about the gospel and the miracle of Jesus. Now, the gospel has taken root in Paul's heart, and he's not just reading the words, he is living it. And we have a word for that. It's called discipleship. Can you guys say that with me? Will you repeat it after me? Let's say it together. 1, 2, 3. Discipleship. That's right. And that's when we do more than just read the Bible or go to church. It's when we let those words take root in our heart and we live it. We don't just go to church. We become the church. We are the body of church, no matter where we are. So we're not just at church on Sunday morning. We are the church to people all the time, every day of the week. The gospel just radiates out of us because we have become a disciple of Jesus Christ. Now, I really love this verse, and it is one thing that God calls us to do, to become disciples of Jesus. So, when we're done today with church, I want you to think of one way that you can become a disciple of Jesus. Maybe it's reading your Bible more and letting those words soak into your heart. Maybe it's volunteering or helping others. We're getting ready to come up on Lent, and we're doing a really cool thing in our church where we're helping getting food to people that are hungry. There are many, many ways where we can put our faith into action, no matter how old we are or how young we are. And when we let those actions take root in our heart and the gospel takes root in our heart, then we are truly living as disciples of Jesus Christ. Will you guys join me in prayer? You can repeat after me. Dear God, help me to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. Help the gospel to take root in my heart. And help me to tell anyone and everyone about Jesus. Amen. Okay, guys, hope you have a great day.
Certain scriptures are worth repeating. And I appreciate Julia's version of the scripture that I will read from the New Revised Standard Version. It is Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 9, verses 16 through 23. If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, for an obligation is laid on me, and woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews I became as a Jew in order to win Jews. To those under the law I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I might by all means save people. I do this for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessings. This is God's word for us this morning.
Thank you so much, Linda. And I want to say a special thank you to Molly Shivers, Reverend Molly Shivers, and to John McLeod for covering for me last week. And it was a blessing to be with my family. We went to Myrtle Beach to watch my older daughter dance in one of her dance competitions during her senior year. So you can imagine it was something important to Daddy's heart to go and be part of. And I thank you for your hospitality, your graciousness. And I thank Molly and John for their leadership as well, and all of you for all you do. Hear now the word of God from Mark 1, 29 through 39. As soon as they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, so they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick and possessed with demons. And the whole city was gathered around the door, and he cured many who were sick with various diseases, and cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go into the neighboring towns, that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. May God add a blessing to the reading of the word today. You may or may not remember this, but sometime in the 90s or maybe the aughts, American Express had a slogan: "Membership has its privileges." Remember? Some of you remember that one. It must have stuck. It meant that if you, I guess, paid the annual fee or whatever it was that you had to do to get an American Express card, then there were benefits to be had, and they wanted you to know that if you became a member of their exclusive program, you would have benefits and privileges. I was thinking about that old slogan today as I read this gospel text and considered the ministry of Jesus and the disciples, because I don't see them living a life of great privilege. I see responsibilities and expectations among them. I see them being asked to support Jesus' work in the world, his ministry in one way or another. And I see them rising to the need. To follow Jesus meant a life of discipleship. And perhaps that's the rub for today. That Jesus called people not to be members or admirers, but disciples. Over the early centuries of the church, there became a way of asking someone to become a disciple of Jesus and baptizing them to become a disciple of Jesus. And they thought of themselves not so much as then a member of the church, but as a disciple of Jesus. And because you were a disciple, you gathered with the other disciples, and eventually we started calling that church. And eventually we started coming up with things to say, well, at what point are you committing yourself enough to become a member of the church? But it was committing yourself to being a disciple. Somewhere along the way, on multiple occasions in Christian history, church membership, however, became separated from discipleship. And you could join the church and go through the words and say that you were a disciple of Jesus and then become a member of the church. But nobody really held you on it to account for that. Nobody held you to all the different parts of discipleship. Did you read the Bible enough that day? Did you pray? Did you go to church? Membership became something that you kind of added to a lot of other things you were a member of, like your HOA or your country club or something like that. somewhere along the way. In the United Methodist Church of the Resurrection in Leawood, Kansas, they say that they make they want to see discipleship in three ways: through a person's head, heart, and hands. To love God with one's head, they say, is to have a solid understanding of what you believe and why. And that includes reading the Bible and going to a class, be it with the Sunday school teacher or a Bible study or with the pastor or something like that. They say, we expect you to love the Lord with your heart and be a disciple with your heart. That means having a personal relationship with Jesus, attending worship, attending to prayer, having an openness to the work of the Holy Spirit in your life. And they say that being a disciple means being a disciple with your hands. And by that, they mean things like the food collection that we've been doing, the disaster response that we've been doing, the alternate school care and after school care that God has done in our midst through you. But it meant giving your time and your resources and your gifts to show the love of Jesus to others, head, hands, and heart. But there are a lot of ways to describe what discipleship looks like. I just want to give you that one as a bit of a seed planter, if you will. It's consistent with what we say when we promise to support the church with our prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness. The point of this is, if I want you to take away one thing, it's that Jesus called people to be disciples. And in an ideal world, everybody who becomes a member of the church takes fully and completely and sticks to their discipleship throughout their whole lives. That they stay as committed to being a disciple of Jesus as they were at the very first day, at the day of their confirmation, or the day they joined the church, or the day they made their profession of faith, or their baptism. In an ideal world. But we have to go back and remember that membership is not the same thing as discipleship. Discipleship is its own journey. What is membership without discipleship? Maybe something more akin to the American Express card, or that membership mentality snags that I mentioned before. Any one of us here could pull out our wallets or our keychains or our purses or what have you, and find lots of things that we're members of, you know? Rifle through our little cards. You could do that in your head or even in person, even if you wanted to. You might be probably have a couple of credit cards. Maybe you've got a card that says you're a member at the marina or at the country club. Maybe you've got a fraternal order that you're a member of or a professional organization. I'm a card-carrying, I kid you not, a card-carrying member of the National Association of Parliamentarians. Now, is that not the nerdiest thing you've ever heard? But we agree to things all the time. How many of us really read all the terms and conditions before on our phones and our computers before we click, I agree? Does anybody really read those? No. We are parts and members of a lot of things. We join things, and that's fine. It's fine to make commitments. It's fine to dedicate ourselves to the purposes of an organization. We agree to follow the guidelines and the practices. But let's take all that and apply that to how we listen to Jesus and what we do to follow Jesus. For in today's gospel, this text begs the question of us, do I see myself as a disciple in the way that the disciples did in those early days when they said, hey, Jesus, we had great ministry there. Let's go on to the next city. Or have I settled back into a mentality in which discipleship is not really at the forefront? Do I think of myself as a member of an organization like the church, or more as a disciple of Jesus who has joined in with other people in joining the church? We read in Mark that at sundown, the disciples and others brought to Jesus many people who were sick, and Jesus cured them of their many diseases, and the next morning, he withdrew to pray. And the disciples came, and they said, we did great. That was wonderful. Let's go to the next area and city and the neighboring towns. And along the way, people saw amazing things that Jesus did, and they admired him. And some of them, we presume, became his disciples because it said that more and more people followed him as time went on. But there were some people who watched him and followed him, who watched him but did not necessarily follow him. They became admirers rather than disciples. They got some healing, they had some opportunity to hear some amazing teaching, but when it came down to it, they weren't necessarily going to go with him and make more disciples throughout the cities. It was the great Danish Christian Kierkegaard who said that Christ came seeking followers and got a few dedicated disciples, but many more admirers. Consider for yourself today, are you an admirer of Jesus, or are you a disciple of Jesus? Jesus' disciples went with him, the 12 plus those who didn't just admire him, but who dedicated their lives to what he was doing. And sometimes Jesus would send these disciples out to canvass a city or an area. At some point, he sent out 70 to do so. And then at the day of Pentecost, it said that they listened to the apostles' teaching and thousands more were added to those who were being saved. You see, in that time, the apostles and those who followed them were so near to what it meant to follow Jesus. I mean, really follow Jesus. That it was for them a matter of discipleship, not a matter of membership. They didn't go along and say, would you like to come become a member of the Church of Jesus? They said, the kingdom of God has come near, come follow Jesus. And membership became an outgrowth of that when the church formed. I watched a candid interview with a pastor of one of those mega churches. You ever heard of mega churches? They're the big churches that draw in thousands of people every Sunday, and bless them. I mean, they're doing God's work too. But this candid interview, this pastor said, you know, we bring in upteen thousand people a weekend, and we make 1,000 new members for our church every year. Could you imagine? 1,000 members a year. But then he said, you know, the problem is we lose 1,000 people out the back door too. He said that about 1,000 people come and they get excited, they join, and only a fraction of them, a small fraction, really live a life of discipleship and commit, not just to the church, but to live discipleship. And he said that they go out the back door, they fade away or they find somewhere else. And he said, and studies have even shown that that's been true of a lot of these mega churches. They're very special at attracting people, and bless them for doing that. I want to attract people to Jesus too. But the challenge and opportunity we have is to make disciples of Jesus, not just to attract people like admirers of Jesus. The first Sunday of Lent is coming up in a couple weeks, and there's a little book that's kind of making the rounds in our district, and I decided to use the first five Sundays of Lent to go ahead and teach off of it. It's called Surprise the World by Michael Frost. And I don't expect you to know him, or you don't have to go get a copy or anything like that. You can if you want to, but I'm going to be leading us through the five habits of highly missional people, they call it. These habits include blessing someone, three people, once a week. And one of them has to be someone that's not from your church. I thought that was pretty creative, right? Or the second one is eating with someone each week, but that one person that has to not be a member of your church. Different little things like that. I don't know how we're going to adapt the eating one into the COVID time. We're going to call people or something. But, you know, I'll share the others as we go along. In those five Sundays, we'll have time to go through them. And at the end of those five Sundays, I'm going to ask you and give you an opportunity to form a micro group with three people, you and two others. And it could be two other people you choose, or it could be two other people you could write down on your little card or on your Google form at home. You could say, I don't know who my other two people are. Match me up with some people, you know, whatever. But we're going to make little groups of three, and you can then check in weekly with that group and see how each other are doing with these five habits. Just a little bit of accountability, a little bit of nurture, you know. And you don't have to be perfect. You don't have to already have it all figured out. It's just checking in and being together and doing this discipleship stuff, not just talking about it, you know, but doing it. So look for that a little later. We'll deal with that a little later. We say in our mission statement for Ann Street Church that we exist to make disciples of Jesus Christ by the sea and throughout God's creation. And part of that is making people feel welcome, but part of that is being disciples ourselves and showing people and modeling for people what it is to follow Jesus, to love his word, to listen to him, to try to act and live the way he did. It means thinking in terms of discipleship and not necessarily membership. It starts with us. It starts with you and me. It starts with what you're doing now. You're already doing discipleship just by coming to listen to God's word, read and proclaimed. You're doing discipleship by coming to the table, and we'll have communion today. And so in our way, in our safe way today, we will celebrate the sacraments of the Lord. When you do acts of compassion and mercy together, when you spread the good news and tell someone or invite someone to church with you, you're being a disciple and making disciples. And I want to call you to think back to that first time you made a commitment to be a disciple of Jesus. Maybe it was at summer camp, you know, Christian camp. Maybe it was at church in confirmation class, or maybe you were an adult, or maybe you transferred to the church and you took the vows real seriously this time, you know. Maybe it was some moment in your home and something just came over you. Maybe you went through something in your life and it was powerful and it called you back to be a disciple. Just whatever it is, think back to it. Think back to what that was. And if you're not sure that you ever really made that commitment, I want to call you to make that commitment today, here and now, on what is today, the 7th of February, 2021. I want to call you to make that commitment, and we're going to leave the rail open for you to do so if you during this next musical piece in just a moment. But even if you've made that commitment before, if you've made that first-time commitment, I want to invite you to recommit. Maybe today you are deciding, well, I am committed, I'm a disciple, but you know what? I'm going to focus on discipleship and not membership. I'm going to take discipleship to a new level. I'm going to get serious about it with the Lord's help. Maybe today that's what you're coming down and saying. And if you don't feel comfortable coming down, pray it in your pew. That's fine. But the whole thing today is to get ready for a Holy Lent in which you have an opportunity to focus upon discipleship and to take inventory of your life. And to remember that membership is not the same thing as discipleship. For you are not called to be an admirer of Jesus, but a disciple, a follower of Jesus. Won't you come? And won't you consider it at least? Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
I could see not just in your faces, but I could feel in your hearts that you're committing yourself and recommitting yourself to discipleship. Bless you. That is exactly what the Spirit calls us to today. And God be with you, and I will be with you and as you do that. Thanks be to God. Amen. If you give God praise, I know we're trying not to say too many words altogether out loud like amen. So give God praise with your thankfulness. Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God. We are praying for one another, and for those of you online, I know you have been sending in your prayer concerns, and John has feverishly been writing them down. He's wiping his brow now. What did he say? I think he's got a fever. Got a fever. Don't use it. Yeah, that's right. That's right. We'll think he has a fever. That's right. No, he's been writing down our prayer concerns very faithfully. Thank you so much, John. I want to lift up various ones that are in your prayer list in the church too. Of course, all of our homebound and our those in assisted living, we want to pray for them. We're praying for Fran Krautheim and Sarah Sorrell, who have important opportunities this coming week for healing. We want to pray for the John Pachiza, is that probably right? Family, okay. We want to pray for Beverly Pigford. She is home from the hospital, but needs our prayers so much in this time. For Don Rutz and for the family of Buddy McCarthy. Kelly Hobgood is having gallbladder surgery on Thursday, so we want to pray for her. Jerry Currier continues rehab in Durham, and we want to remember her as well. And Joanne Mangum and the family on the death of her father. Joanne's father passed away, and we're very sorry. The family and friends of two young men who recently lost their battle with addiction. And we are connected with our Loaves and Fishes program, and there have been two losses among the community of those who were fighting addiction. So please remember those as well. Mary Fawn Jones has a birthday this week. I've also heard that today is Virginia Moore's 97th birthday. And Al Serkin's birthday is today too. And Al is running the live stream from his home. He's working there. Everything that people at home are watching, it's because of Doug and Al and Sue. And we thank them. today is the 1 year anniversary since Kurt Berry had an artificial heart valve. So he is celebrating that things are going very well for him. So thanks be to God all around, and thanks be to God for all the blessings. Maybe there are other prayers of the people that we have missed in the room or need to hear from the room. I'll give you a moment to think of if there's any you want to share. One more. For Joe and Brian Mathis and their family. Meg Bradford. Prayers for Jeannie Gray, who just had her last chemo treatment. Thank you. Okay. If there are no others, Joe, please. Joe's parents. I know. Both of Joe's parents tested positive for COVID. All right. Well, we will pray for them. And truly, though, of course, they are not that you're not a young man, too, Joe. But I would only guess that they are in a age of concern. So we want to remember them too, as I know you are. Okay. Yes, Julia. Yes. Yes, the family of Fran McMillan, a dear person in our conference. Not from around here, but her husband and her son were both pastors, and her son died ahead of his time as well some years ago. So the McMillan family in the conference, we want to pray for them. Very good. Well, let us go before God together as prayerful people. Thank you. Oh, Heavenly Lord, you have taught us today about membership and discipleship and reminded us what it means to follow you. You've called us to recommitment, and we thank you that we have given our lives over to you again and will do so by your grace over and over again, because we are not all going to stay perfect in this journey you've given us. So call us today to take you seriously if we haven't been doing so. Call us today to look for ways to make changes in our lives where changes need to be made, to comport more with your values and your word. Call us today to go forth and continue to make disciples by our example, by how we love one another and love our community and those around us. For that is why you came to save for us, for all creation. And that is why you came and taught us so many things, including how to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Amen. At this time, I invite Linda Hevner to join me as we lead you in our great Thanksgiving for communion. We prepare our hearts and minds for this holy sacrament. You know, we have not all been able to be here together for the sacrament. I'm thankful that you're here today, and I hope that you will take a moment to find the elements in a small container near you. Linda, I'll give you one too. And
thank you.
These are pre-sealed, and so go ahead and make sure you have enough for you and your family. If not, the ushers are looking around and checking to make sure you have what you need, and we'll make sure we get you. We have extras. Just raise your hand. These are not our usual favorite way, are they, to serve communion, but these are the safest way right now. Don't know if you've opened it yet, don't worry, nothing bad is going to happen to you, but just wait and open it in just a few minutes if you haven't opened it already. For those of you watching online, because we United Methodists emphasize the presence of the elements themselves when I preside over communion, I'm blessing only the elements in the room, but the good news is I'm blessing several extras that we have for you. And we want you to let us know and reach out to us. Perhaps you even have someone who brings you communion every time by now. Some of you do. But if you don't have anybody to bring you communion, I would be glad to. We have other volunteers in the church that would like to. And all you have to do is reach out and let us know. And that will be brought to your home. And we'll do it in whatever, bring it to you in whatever safe way you want. If you just want us to leave it on the porch, we'll do that. Or if you want us to visit on the porch, we'll do that. But you do know that you're not left out. We are praying with you, but we are partaking of these blessed elements here in our presence. Let us begin this word together. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another.
Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
I invite you to pray a silent prayer of confession. And now to hear the good news, that Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth.
In the beginning, when darkness covered the face of the earth and nothing existed but chaos, your Spirit swept across the waters.
You spoke but a word, and light was separated from darkness. And so your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, who lived among us and knew human pain and suffering, who called all who were burdened and heavy laden and gave them rest, who healed the sick and fed the hungry and ate with sinners, who cast out demons and showed us the way to you through faith, who took our suffering upon himself that we might be cleansed of our sins and receive eternal life.
By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made us a new covenant by water and the Spirit.
On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread. He gave thanks to you, O God. He broke the bread and he gave it to his disciples. And he said, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we today offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of our faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pray with me some more. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us who are gathered here, O God, and on these gifts of bread and wine, and make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your same Spirit, heal us in body, mind, and spirit. Protect us from the virus, and cleanse away all that would separate us from you. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet.
Through your Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
Amen. And now we may take our portion and open the very top thin film layer to reveal the wafer. Holding it before us, we remember this is the body of Christ broken for us. Thanks be to God. And opening the full film, we then find the cup of Christ. This is the blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. Thanks be to God. Simply leave the receptacle on the pew beside you. Thank you. Let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us.
Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
We have received this morning a beautiful gift, and it is time now for us to return our gifts and tithes and offerings at this moment. There's many ways in which you are able to do that. You can certainly mail it or drop it off at the church office here, 417 Ann Street here in Beaufort. You can leave it in the receptacle as you leave church this morning. Or you can go online to annstreet.org.
annstreetumc.org/give.
It's a good thing he's here. And you're going to hit the general offering tab if this is your intention. So thank you very much. I'm going to do the prayer from here, if that's all right with you. So our prayer of dedication for our tithes, offerings, and gifts today is as follows. God, you have created the universe. Everything we see has come into being because of you. With great joy, we now offer our own gifts, given with grateful hearts. We are thankful for the opportunity to put these gifts to work, proclaiming your gospel of love. Amen. Our music of sending forth is brought to you again by video by the Ann Street Church Choir, When God Dips His Love.
What a blessing to be together today, and thank you for being with us in person and online. I believe that the ashes were found, Lee, weren't they? Did I see that? So be sure to pick up one little baggie per family. I promise you, a tiny little bit. It looks like doesn't look like much, but you mix some oil, it'll go a long way for your whole family. So don't worry, one little baggie. I want to thank you again for being a part of this and for sending forth together. With proper safety, we're going to mask as we go forward, and we're going to dismiss from those closest to the door to those furthest from the door. But that's all right, because we're going out to serve Jesus. We're going out to remember what he told us, and what how he sent us out to go in service to God and neighbor. May we go forth to be disciples, not just members or admirers. In Jesus' name, amen.